I'm Peter Brown from Tiny and Sons Glass. Tiny and Sons Glass was established in 1978 with my father and brother and I. We're at 575 Washington Street in Pembroke. We're certified and qualified to do all your windshield replacement and repair. Tiny and Sons Glass is a community-based business. We have 12 mobile vans that come to you. If the weather's bad, you can come here to the shop. We have a nice waiting area, TV, Wi-Fi, kid-friendly, pet-friendly. We also can move about 15, 20 cars a day through the shop. Perfect for you when the weather's bad. So come on down to Tiny and Sons Glass if you need your windshield replaced or repaired. Tiny and Sons Glass, 1-888-64-TINIES. Just call. Thank you.
I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the Eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Monday, April 10th meeting of the Pembroke Board of Selectmen, and we'll begin with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and audio broadcast on Comcast Government Access Channel 15 and is being recorded for broadcast at future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded. We'll start the evening's schedule. We have with us with the Chamber of Commerce, Mr. Peter Brown, who's going to talk to us about his business. Peter, would you like to come right up front, please?
Good evening, everyone. My name is Peter Brown. I'm the president of Tiny and Sons Glass in Pembroke. We're right on 575 Washington Street. We're right across the street from Dairy Twist. We moved there about 3 years ago. Best thing we ever did. It's a beautiful facility. I was able to get my dad in there to show him everything set up before he passed away this August. It was great. We're at the other location since 1988. So we've been in business all together in the town of Pembroke since 1978. So it's a good family business. We have 14 employees running right now. We have seven mobile vans that come out and do all the work we can, any kind of windshield replacement that you need. Tonight I'm also here representing the Pembroke Chamber of Commerce. The Pembroke Chamber has been viable since 1990. We have 86 businesses that are in town that are registered through the Pembroke Chamber of Commerce and looking for more. This year we've got after hours going on every Tuesday, second Tuesday of every month. The next after hours we're going to have is going to be at the Council of Aging tomorrow night, 5:30. So anybody that wants to come will be there from 5:30 to 7. There'll be light refreshments and appetizers, and we'll be able to give you an update of what the Council of Aging is doing. One of the things that that Tiny and Sons does is, especially my dad used to do, we're a viable business. We do a lot of community service and stuff, and it's been instilled in us since we've been in business. Boy Scouts and all the schools and stuff through the years, and we try to continue it. One of the things that's we've been sponsoring has been Pembroke Day, which is going to be coming up on August 19th. We're looking for sponsors, businesses, and local people to sponsor that also. So other than that, I appreciate you letting me speak. And if anybody, any businesses out there that want to join the Pembroke Chamber of Commerce, just stop by my shop and I got applications for everybody. Hopefully see everybody tomorrow night at the Council on Aging. Thank you.
Very good, Peter.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Peter.
Thanks for all you do too, Pete.
Oh, no, thank you guys. You guys are doing awesome. Have a good night.
All right, thank you for coming in, Peter. I think everybody in Pembroke by now knows Tiny's Auto Glass Company, especially Peter is carrying on for his father and has for many years. And Tiny Brown, as everyone also knows, has been a great citizen of Pembroke and a man who never said no to a charitable event. So we all miss Tiny Brown. He's going to be on it soon down at Route 53 with a special plaque, and when we get more information on when that date is going to be, we'll let the public know. Yes, Ed.
I believe I circulated an email to members of the board, and I think they're looking at May the 23rd as the tentative date for that ceremony at the intersection of 1453.
Very good.
Know what time?
They don't have time yet.
Oh.
Okay. We will be hearing from the superintendent of schools at about 7:15, so we can move on to board action items.
Could we have Matthew read the announcement?
I'm sorry.
Hazardous waste.
Hazardous waste. Thank you, Ed. Go ahead, Matthew.
Thank you. So I have one announcement to make tonight about the Household Hazardous Waste Collection Day. And it'll be taking place at Pembroke Recycling Center, which is 158 B Habermock Street, Pembroke, and that'll be taking place on Saturday, April 15th, which is this Saturday, from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. The items which are acceptable and not acceptable are both on the town website, and you must be a town resident, have a current recycling sticker, and you cannot dispose of business or commercial hazardous waste.
Thank you, Matthew. The Hazardous Waste Day has always been a very popular day in Pembroke, and it's an excellent service that the town provides twice a year. We're a little early for our next appointment, so if the board would turn to an appointment for Christine Griffin of 51 Ingram Way on the Zoning Board of Appeals. She was referred by Josh Cutler, and the ZBA would like us to appoint Christine Griffin to their board. So do I have a motion?
I would move to the appointment of Christine Griffin of 53 Ingram Way to the Zoning Board of Appeals, and we're very fortunate to have her.
Second.
Very good. A motion by Arthur and a second by Bill. Any comments or questions? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, hearing none. It's unanimous vote. Thank you. We have a couple of other quick items. Why don't we turn to the minutes of the Selectmen's meeting of April 3rd, 2017. Do I have a motion on those minutes?
I would move the minutes as written.
Motion by Arthur and a second by Bill. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, hearing none. It's unanimous. Okay. Why don't we go then to the first action item? May take a little time for a discussion on this, but this is a vote to reopen the annual town meeting warrant to remove Article 21 and insert a new Article 21.
Move to reopen the annual town meeting warrant.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. A motion by Bill and a second by Arthur. Any questions, comments? All those in favor of reopening the warrant, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. This is, at a previous meeting, we voted favorable action. I'm sorry, I'm looking at the wrong one. Okay. Article 21 that we had approved was a zoning article and required the planning board to hold a public hearing on that article. That public meeting was held, but there were questions that were not resolved, and the planning board rescheduled the public hearing to June 12th. Well, that would be after the town meeting, and that would make that article one that really couldn't be acted on without the planning board having a completed meeting. So what we would like to do is to change the original Article 21, the language in that article, making it again a zoning bylaw, to new language consistent with general laws 94G, Chapter 3, all types of marijuana establishments as defined in general law, Chapter 94G, Section 1J, to include marijuana cultivators, marijuana testing facilities, marijuana product manufacturers, marijuana retailers, or any other types of licensed marijuana-related businesses shall be prohibited within the town of Pembroke. Any person violating this bylaw shall be fined by not more than $300. That is the language of the replacement article. Do I have questions or comments from the board? Bill?
I have a question. You said that it would make that another zoning bylaw, and I don't think that it actually comes under the town of Pembroke bylaws under the police regulations under Section 14B.
Right. Instead of a zoning bylaw, it'll be a general bylaw.
Right. Be a general bylaw under police regulations.
Right. Thank you for pointing that out, Bill. And if I can add, because it would be a general bylaw, it would not require a planning board public hearing. That would be just for the zoning bylaw, which will continue and could be taken up in the fall. So that is a replacement to the original Article 21, and we would like to insert that in the annual. So any
question.
Other questions or comments?
Question.
Yes, Dan.
Does this in any way inhibit medical marijuana facilities in town?
Well, right now the board has the ability, and you've already turned down one medical marijuana dispensary. So I don't think so, but I'm glad to let the board know.
My understanding is that we have some documentation here as well from Koppelman and Page, which explains the situation that the state is facing and also gives us some model ballot questions that would accomplish various things. And the wording of this is taken from Koppelman and Page. I thought, my own opinion would be that it would affect medical marijuana.
I don't think it does, Lou. When I asked that, I wanted to be specific because it references references the state law that I don't know verbatim, but I believe that they're separate and apart from one another. This what we're looking at here speaks to recreational marijuana, not medical marijuana.
Right.
And I wanted to be sure from Ed because, as I say, I don't know the law verbatim, so I'd like him to check that. There are some folks in town that I know may go along with this sentiment of disallowing any recreational facilities, but want to keep the door open for medical marijuana facilities. It's not necessarily this board's take on it, but there are some folks in town that feel that way. I want to make sure it's clear to them when they go to vote at town meeting.
Okay, so, well, you have a recommendation, Ed, on this, with this question?
Yeah, I think that, and as you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, that zoning bylaw still is, you know, could be alive and well in the fall. I mean, there are communities that have done the trifecta where they have passed a general bylaw, a zoning bylaw, and a ballot question. The town of Westboro actually did all three. So, obviously this general bylaw is going to have to be approved by the Attorney General's office.
Yeah, they have to approve that anyway. I don't think it would hurt to get the feeling of the public on it anyway. It would be something to bring before.
And we'll have an answer to Dan's question shortly.
Yeah, I think Dan's question is a good one, because if you have a medical marijuana facility, you also have the opportunity to grab one of the first 75 retail licenses available. So we could get one and the other, and I support the efforts of Chief Wall, and I think this is a referendum on his wanting to not have a marijuana facility of any kind in the town of Pembroke, and he's the expert, so I would go along with Chief Wall and support this as an alternative for now.
Okay. Any other comments? Is there a motion on this, please?
Move Article 21 as written here, about police regulations under Section 14B.
Motion by Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Matthew. All those in favor of Bill's motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, that's unanimous. Thank you very much. We do have... What's that?
You ready for the National School Committee to show up?
Yes.
We have the budget subcommittee and three of our members.
Thank you very much.
So I feel like this is like the firing squad.
Patrick. Line them up. Mr. Trappiano will be here sometime, yeah. But you get us.
Definitely look different.
Great. That's not to the side or...
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's 7:15 and the school committee has arrived. Thank you for coming in. And we have the superintendent as well with us. Thank you for being here. And you want to discuss with us your budget plan.
Before I start, Ed, I don't know if, since we were waiting outside, if you talked to them about the conversation we had today earlier, about the number, or no?
No.
So.
Mike is on his way in the building.
So in your packet is some slides that we just put together to kind of illustrate the current state of our budget. And I will preface it by saying that that was information as of Friday. Ed and I did have a nice lengthy conversation today, as well as the House budget number came in for Chapter 70 also, so it went up to $30 a student as opposed to the 20 that we had been given in the governor's budget. So there is some updates to the presentation. So on the first page, when you're looking at it, our FY17 budget is $31,332,029. When we talk about this, we talk about it in the context of maintenance effort, which is doing everything we're doing next year. This year, at next year's prices, would be $38,594. So that left us with a budget gap of $1.2 million. As I just said a minute ago, the Chapter 70 number did go up to $30 a student. So we're expecting revenue. After speaking with Ed today, the initial number that he had given us was, I think, what, $560. It has gone up to $826. So there's new revenue of $960,000. So the budget gap that we're solving for is $345, which is a better place than we were on Friday. So a lot of gains over the weekend. Also in your packet is just a breakout of what the maintenance of effort budget increases are. As we've been saying all along, the largest chunk of that is collective bargaining increases. So our collective bargaining increase similar to the other town units is 2%. So we have the five bargaining units, the teachers, the paraprofessionals, cafeteria workers, custodians, and secretaries. So all of those COLA increase as well as the steps and lanes comes to about $894,000. And that's the number that we've been working with Ed and Mike Buckley on solving for. In addition to that, we have other budget increases that are mandated and I would easily say outside of our control. Things like sped tuitions and vocational tuitions. We're expecting an increase of about $200,000 in tuitions for next year. And again, that's not something that we have any say over. It's mandated. A student is placed at a residential placement for special education, or any of our high school students choose to exercise their right for vocational tuition. We don't have any say in that. We just have to pay the bill. The other kind of big piece of that is transportation. We've been to you a few times about our transportation contract with First Student. We've had some favorable increases with them year over year. We are in the first option year of a 3+2 contract with them, and the increase for transportation for next year is about $53,000. On top of all of those pieces, we also have a pretty unique situation next year that we're facing as far as preschool. We have three preschool classes right now at North Pembroke Elementary School. Next year, we're going to have to add another one for the number of students that are coming out of early intervention. So early intervention is the pathway that students with special needs are in until they're 3 years old, and then they come to the school system. The number of students coming out of that early intervention pipeline is a little bit larger than we had been planning for. So next year, we're in a situation where we need to add an additional preschool teacher. So on top of our maintenance of effort budget, we have an additional teacher that we would need in order to, again, fill what would be a required mandate. So with that, we're looking at about a $410,000 gap. We have gone through our budget, I would say, maybe 11, 12, 30 times at this point to identify any savings that we can find. We've come up with a few scenarios there. There's retirements year over year that get us some salary breakage. We have some leaves. And we also do an offset from our transportation revolving fund because we do charge for our secondary transportation, which leaves us, I was speaking with Ed earlier today about it, leaves us about $130,000 to solve for, which isn't a crazy number. It's still a conversation around what maintenance of effort is and just keeping the department whole year over year. I know we talked about all the other budgets in the town and the departments being level funded, so exactly the same. And for us, level funded with these state mandated increases still leaves us with a gap of about $130,000. Questions or anybody want to add anything?
No, I think the one thing that is really important, I think, for you guys to understand is of all of these things that are driving the incremental year on year, and we face this every year, I mean, we have a very similar conversation annually, these aren't optional items, right? So the items that are here, we can't elect not to do. They're classic unfunded mandates. So whether it's, you know, vocational tuition or some of the special education elections, you know, we have to transport by law elementary students. And then even part of the $894,000 on the contractual increases is mandated by law, which is the steps and lanes portion that Aaron broke out for you. Those are all mandated by law. The increases that are in the collective bargaining contract, which we've given you guys a ton of history on and a ton of statistics on, are on average one of the lower increases that most town employees have received over the last 8 to 10 years. All in all, so it's not as though those are out of whack or out of line with what we've done with the rest of the town government. So I just thought it was important that you guys understood that.
Do you have any questions?
I'd like to hear from Ed your thoughts on this.
Yeah, you know, after the conversation we had today, we had narrowed the gap down to about 160,000, and with the news about Chapter 70 money. So it appears now that the gap is around the 130,000 range.
Why don't we go then to the first action item? May take a little time for a discussion on this, but this is a vote to reopen the annual town meeting warrant to remove Article 21 and insert a new Article 21.
Move to reopen the annual town meeting warrant.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. A motion by Bill and a second by Arthur. Any questions, comments? All those in favor of reopening the warrant, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. This is, at a previous meeting, we voted favorable action. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm looking at the wrong one. Okay. Article 21 that we had approved was a zoning article and required the planning board to hold a public hearing on that article. That public meeting was held, but there were questions that were not resolved, and the planning board rescheduled the public hearing to June 12th. Well, that would be after the town meeting, and that would make that article one that really couldn't be acted on without the planning board having a completed meeting. So what we would like to do is to change the original Article 21, the language in that article, making it again a zoning bylaw, to new language consistent with general laws, 94G, Chapter 3, all types of marijuana establishments as defined in general law, Chapter 94G, Section 1J, to include marijuana cultivators, marijuana testing facilities, marijuana product manufacturers, marijuana retailers, or any other types of licensed marijuana-related businesses shall be prohibited within the town of Pembroke. Any person violating this bylaw shall be fined by not more than $300. That is the language of the replacement article. Do I have questions or comments from the board? Bill?
I have a question. You said that it would make that another zoning bylaw, and I don't think that it actually comes under the town of Pembroke bylaws under the police regulations under Section 14B.
Right. Instead of a zoning bylaw, it'll be a general bylaw.
Right. Be a general bylaw under police regulations.
Right. Thank you for pointing that out, Bill. And if I can add, because it would be a general bylaw, it would not require a planning board public hearing. That would be just for the zoning bylaw, which will continue and could be taken up in the fall. So that is a replacement to the original Article 21, and we would like to insert that in the annual. So any
question.
Other questions or comments?
Question.
Yes, Dan.
Does this in any way inhibit medical marijuana facilities in town?
Well, right now the board has the ability, and you've already turned down one medical marijuana dispensary. So I don't think so, but I'd be glad to let the board know.
My understanding is that we have some documentation here as well from Koppelman and Page, which explains the situation that the state is facing and also gives us some model ballot questions that would accomplish various things. And the wording of this is taken from Koppelman and Page. I thought, my own opinion would be that it would affect medical marijuana.
I don't think it does, Lou. When I asked that, I wanted to be specific because it references references the state law that I don't know verbatim, but I believe that they're separate and apart from one another. This is what we're looking at here speaks to recreational marijuana, not medical marijuana.
Right.
And I wanted to be sure from Ed, because as I say, I don't know the law verbatim, so I'd like him to check that. There are some folks in town that I know may go along with this sentiment of disallowing any recreational facilities, but want to keep the door open for medical marijuana facilities. It's not necessarily this board's take on it, but there are some folks in town that feel that way. And I want to make sure it's clear to them when they go to vote at town meeting.
Okay, so you have a recommendation, Ed, on this, with this question?
Yeah, I think that, and as you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, that zoning bylaw still is, you know, could be alive and well in the fall. I mean, there are communities that have done a trifecta where they have passed a general bylaw, a zoning bylaw, and a ballot question. The town of Westboro actually did all three. So, obviously this general bylaw is going to have to be approved by the Attorney General's office.
Yeah, they have to approve that anyway. So.
Right.
I don't think it would hurt to get the feeling of the public on it anyway. It would be something to bring before.
And we'll have an answer to Dan's question shortly.
Yeah, I think Dan's question is a good one, because if you have a medical marijuana facility, you also have the opportunity to grab one of the first 75 retail licenses available. So we could get one and the other, and I support the efforts of Chief Wall, and I think this is a referendum on his wanting to not have a marijuana facility of any kind in the town of Pembroke, and he's the expert, so I would go along with Chief Wall and support this as an alternative for now.
Okay. Any other comments? Is there a motion on this, please?
Move Article 21 as written here about police regulations under Section 14B.
Motion by Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Matthew. All those in favor of Bill's motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. That's unanimous. Thank you very much. We do have...
You ready for the National School Committee to show up?
Yes.
We have a budget subcommittee and three of our members.
Thank you very much.
So I feel like this is like the firing squad.
Line them up. Mr. Trappiano will be here sometime, yeah. But you get us.
Definitely look different.
Great. That's not to the side or
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's 7:15 and the school committee has arrived. Thank you for coming in. And we have the superintendent as well with us. Thank you for being here. And you want to discuss with us your budget plan.
Before I start, Ed, I don't know if, since we were waiting outside, if you talked to them about the conversation we had today earlier, about the number, or no?
No.
So.
Mike is on his way in the building.
No,
go ahead, start.
So in your packet is some slides that we just put together to kind of illustrate the current state of our budget. And I will preface it by saying that that was information as of Friday. Ed and I did have a nice lengthy conversation today, as well as the House budget number came in for Chapter 70 also, so it went up to $30 a student as opposed to the $20 that we had been given in the governor's budget. So there is some updates to the presentation. So on the first page, when you're looking at it, our FY17 budget is $31,332,029. When we talk about this, we talk about it in the context of maintenance effort, which is doing everything we're doing next year. This year, at next year's prices, would be $32,594. So that left us with a budget gap of $1.2 million. As I just said a minute ago, the Chapter 70 number did go up to $30 a student. So we're expecting revenue. after speaking with Ed today, the initial number that he had given us was, I think, what, 560? It has gone up to 826. So there's new revenue of $960,000. So the budget gap that we're solving for is 345, which is a better place than we were on Friday. So a lot of gains over the weekend. Also in your packet is just a breakout of what the maintenance of effort budget increases are. As we've been saying all along, the largest chunk of that is collective bargaining increases. So our collective bargaining increase, similar to the other time units, is 2%. So we have the 5 bargaining units: the teachers, the paraprofessionals, cafeteria workers, custodians, and secretaries. So all of those COLA increase, as well as the steps and lanes, comes to about $894,000. And that's the number that we've been working with Ed and Mike Buckley on solving for. In addition to that, we have other budget increases that are mandated, and I would easily say outside of our control. Things like sped tuitions and vocational tuitions. We're expecting an increase of about $200,000 in tuitions for next year. And again, that's not something that we have any say over. It's mandated. A student is placed at a residential placement for special education, or any of our high school students choose to exercise their right for vocational tuition. We don't have any say in that. We just have to pay the bill. The other kind of big piece of that is transportation. We've been to you a few times about our transportation contract with First Student. We've had some favorable increases with them year over year. We are in the first option year of a 3+2 contract with them, and the increase for transportation for next year is about $53,000. On top of all of those pieces, we also have a pretty unique situation next year that we're facing as far as preschool. We have three preschool classes right now at North Pembroke Elementary School. Next year, we're going to have to add another one for the number of students that are coming out of early intervention. So early intervention is the pathway that students with special needs are in until they're 3 years old, and then they come to the school system. The number of students coming out of that early intervention pipeline is a little bit larger than we had been planning for. So next year, we're in a situation where we need to add an additional preschool teacher. So on top of our maintenance of effort budget, we have an additional teacher that we would need in order to, again, fill what would be a required mandate. So with that, we're looking at about a $410,000 gap. We have gone through our budget, I would say, maybe 11, 12, 30 times at this point to identify any savings that we can find. We've come up with a few scenarios there. There's retirements year over year that get us some salary breakage. We have some leaves. And we also do an offset from our transportation revolving fund, because we do charge for our secondary transportation, which leaves us, I was speaking with Ed earlier today about it, leaves us about $130,000 to solve for, which isn't a crazy number. It's still a conversation around what maintenance of effort is and just keeping the department whole year over year. I know we talked about all the other budgets in the town and the departments being level funded, so exactly the same. And for us, level funded with these state mandated increases still leaves us with a gap of about $130,000. If you have any questions or anybody wants to add anything?
No, I think the one thing that is really important, I think, for you guys to understand is of all of these things that are driving the incremental year on year, and we face this every year, I mean, we have a very similar conversation annually, these aren't optional items, right? So the items that are here, we can't elect not to do. They're classic unfunded mandates. So whether it's, you know, vocational tuition or some of the special education elections, we have to transport by law elementary students. And then even part of the $894,000 on the contractual increases is mandated by law, which is the steps and lanes portion that Aaron broke out for you. Those are all mandated by law. The increases that are in the collective bargaining contract, which we've given you guys a ton of history on and a ton of statistics on, are on average one of the lower increases that most town employees have received over the last 8 to 10 years. All in all, so it's not as though those are out of whack or out of line with what we've done with the rest of the town government. So I just thought it was important that you guys understood that.
Do you have any questions?
I'd like to hear from Ed your thoughts on this.
Yeah, you know, after the conversation we had today, we had narrowed the gap down to about 160,000, and with the news about Chapter 70 money. So it appears now that the gap is around the 130,000 range, and that's where we are as of today.
3 o'clock.
So we're whittling away at the difference between their maintenance of effort proposal and what the town has been able to afford to date. So, like I said, we're closing the gap. We're still working on it. But like I said, at this point, we're about $130,000, short from what, Mr. Chilcott had, and superintendent had proposed and chatted about.
And we're still not 100% because we've seen the House's budget proposal. Senate is last act, and then conference committee, so
I think generally history has been whatever the House comes out on Chapter 70 has stuck.
Yeah.
Generally, the governor comes out at the highest, and then we've seen the House come out at a much lower number. Now, the past couple of years, the House has actually funded it higher than the governor. We feel pretty comfortable, and I think I'm not speaking for him because I haven't talked about it, but especially if you ask Mike Buckley, you feel pretty confident, more confident with the House number than any of the numbers that have been proposed. Even if the governor number happened, that's only a $30,000 difference. Obviously, $30,000 is a lot of money, but I think we would be comfortable that we could go into town meeting with just that $5 difference.
Sure.
Per pupil, which is what the House added, $10, which added the $30,000. So that's kind of how we feel. We did ask, so we had a few asks when Representative Cutler came to meet with us about a month ago. One was a local aid resolution, which would lock those numbers in by the end of this month. I don't know if that's been proposed at this point, but we asked for that. The reason why, main reason why, is so we can go to town meeting. You know, be a little selfish, but as you know, when those local aid resolutions pass, it's very helpful to us. Mm-hmm. That's the first thing. We also asked for at least this House, Senate, and Beacon Hill, look at special education and vocational tuitions. One of the challenges we have is we're bound by what the town revenues can provide. In what town meeting votes. The vocational ed or special education, they're not held to the same standard. Vocational ed, if they're part of a multi-school district, have to pass a majority of towns, similar to what we saw with Silver Lake. Same thing with special education providers. There's certain ways in which they have to calculate the tuition, but they're allowed to increase and put things into their budget that we don't have the luxury of. So we asked for either them to put in a period of freezing them until state revenues came back, or at least mark their tuition increases to some type of benchmark cost of living so that they can't go up quicker than we can, right? When we met with advisory, town revenues generally only can go up to 2.5% plus new growth. Well, that's 50% of our budget. If the other number isn't increasing, that means our budget number is probably going to go up between 1.5% to 1.75%, maybe 2% if we get really lucky. So we asked for that when he was in. You know, the other thing we did ask for is for the state to look again at the circuit breaker special education cost. As Superintendent Obie mentioned, we have a lot of tuitions that we're getting hit with because we can't service these students in town. Between transportation and tuition, we're trying to get them to at least help us there. The circuit breaker right now only funds the tuition portion. If we have to transport that student to Needham, and they're the only person in a hospital van, that's almost as much as the tuition, but we can't claim that on the circuit breaker.
And to be clear, Mike, circuit breaker doesn't cover 100% tuition.
Correct. So circuit breaker, just for those of you who aren't aware, circuit breaker takes four times the foundation budget and then pays a percentage of that after the four times the foundation. So we're still not, we don't have all of our special education tuitions that qualify, thank you, and we don't have all of the monies that we pay that come back. So we're really we ask, because we keep getting asked by them, what can they do for us? And we thought we came up with three or four pretty solid asks that wouldn't be Pembroke specific or urban versus rural. These are items that would be consistent whether you were in Boston, Springfield, Lowell, Pembroke, Upton, wherever. There's something that is consistent with which everybody is seeing. So
one of the practices that we have too, just for further clarification, is every year we ask the superintendent to come back so that we can understand if there's a possibility for us to provide other programs that may fit into a need for special education here, and that might afford tuition to come into us. So if we can create a program for a certain number of students, therefore keeping some students in certain need in Pembroke, we keep our own Pembroke kids here too, and we offer a special program that would come to Pembroke. We haven't been able to create anything right now because it wasn't cost effective, but in years past we have. So when we say we must send students out of district, it's not that we haven't tried to create the most viable education for not only our own students who have special needs, but others who may come to Pembroke. That's one year-over-year ask that we ask the superintendent to review so that not only we can know, but now pass that on to you too. So some of our programs have been able to keep students in district as well as help defray the cost of sending students out to other programs and sending out with special transportation.
Right, then it has to be so difficult for you though, because there's certain children have certain special needs that they're in, there are only so many facilities in the area.
Well, and I think the thing that's important about that, Dan, is you're exactly right, and I know we've talked about this before over the years, but if a student with those needs moves into your district, you become financially responsible. Mm-hmm. Some of these tuitions can be $100,000, $150,000, $200,000 per pupil, right? And those are the things that we're constantly balancing and weighing. I know Aaron's, you know, had done a great job this year with the budget. We've had a couple move-ins like that this year. This put a lot of strain, a financial strain, on the current year's budget, right. But it also extends into the following year budget, and it's one of the things we're dealing with next year. Do you all also, just to make sure everyone's clear, understand what a maintenance of effort budget does and is?
That was my next question. I wish you'd explain that, because we're not really familiar with that term here on the town side of things.
Sure. So maintenance of effort is doing everything you're doing today rolled forward at next year's prices. So you make the adjustments for collective bargaining increases, we make them for the tuition cost increases, transportation contracts, you know, just the mere fact that copy paper is going to be 50 cents more a ream than it was this year. So it's literally the exact level of service you're providing this year at what you're anticipating next year's cost to be. So it's not, we're not doing anything new, we're not doing anything, we're doing exciting things, but they're not new. But it's just literally rolling over at a future year cost.
Ultimately, it's a lot of what you're doing on the town side. You know, collective bargaining agreements, when they get agreed to, our separate town meeting article versus ours, which roll up into our budgets, but then that gets rolled into the following year's budget. And when they have certain line items within their budget, you know, generally those roll up and either roll forward or stay. If they stay the same, then they're clearly buying less whatever with it. In our situation, what we do is we just take the budget and roll over because of the way our budget has to be presented to government for approval.
Okay.
What other questions do you have for us? I know it's always a big number, so it generally has a lot of questions, and we try to inform people. Just so the people watching understand, we give the presentation that we have tonight, we'll put on the school website within the next day or two, along with all of our other budget presentations. So one of the things, you know, the way we do is we look at our budget subject area at a time, meaning that we'll look at teaching and learning, and then we'll look at maybe facilities and athletics. We'll look at, you know, elementary versus secondary. You know, a lot of that overlaps with teaching and learning. But what we try to do is build along the components, so we're looking at a subject area rather than line by line. The reason why is it allows us to potentially shift within a particular, not the teaching subject, but within that subject. In that, all that information is on the website, which also includes what the administration would do, priorities one, priority two, should additional monies ever be available to allow them to continue to move the district forward.
So what do we do about the budget gap? How do we close that?
Hopefully from you guys would do something.
My decision is ready to chat in.
No,
so I think we've been working on it. It's one of those things, it feels late, but it's still early, right? So the House number came out today, but we're still waiting on a couple other numbers. And I think Mike and Ed have been really great about sitting down every time they get new information and, you know, coming to the table always thinking about, you know, how can we solve for this? It's actually, 1:30's a better place than we're at on Friday, so a lot of progress has happened over the weekend, and I think can continue to chip away at it as we get closer. I mean, in a $32 million budget, there is definitely a place for us to start kind of chipping away at the 1:30, so.
I think the other thing that's important, go ahead.
I just have one question on the track replacement. So part of this year, this $890,000 that's here for the track, that's something that has to be done this year or in this year's budget?
It does. That's so let me kind of give a little bit of background on the track, and kind of I can talk to at least the first, I can talk to all the numbers. So when Pembroke High School was renovated, turf fields were put in play. It was the second generation turf fields, and they were starting to come into every building project. If you look at the recent building projects, Abington, Marshfield, the newer ones, even Situate a few years prior, put in turf fields. We put in turf field at the time, which was 13 years ago. They generally have a useful life of 10 to 15. We're smack dab in the middle. We're at the point now that we've done everything we can maintenance-wise to get as much out of it, out of the turf, but also on the track. The track was a medium grade track when the building committee was building it, put in a medium grade track. If you happen to go into the Pembroke High School gym, you'll see our track team is very successful. If you go up there on a sunny afternoon like today, you'll see many students participating, so it gets a lot of use. So we've had a lot of wear and tear on both. So they're at the point where both need to be replaced. As you mentioned, it's an $890,000 project between the two. $540,000 for the turf replacement and $350,000 for the track. Now again, we're looking at again another 10 to 15 year useful life out of that. With that said, we are, you know, of the 890, we've already allocated through user fees for use of the field over the many use of the turf field over the years and through the athletic revolving account. We've already allocated $200,000, leaving $690,000, which needs to be financed. We would propose financing that over 10 years. The reason why we're proposing 10 years is it has a useful life of 15. If we can get the 15 out of it, even if we get 13, that gives us 3 years without any type of payment to start saving for the next one. We're hoping maybe even longer. These are, again, we're in the third generation of turf. And this also will have the concussion pad put in, which is being highly recommended. It's a little bit more money, but it also keeps our students safe. And also the youth groups who use it, which gets a lot of community use. So that said, we're estimating off of the 690 bond payments over those 10 years of about $75,000. Within that $75,000, the way we're proposing funding that is user fee increases of $10,000 per year. We're voting tomorrow evening on what to move the athletic user fee to, and the with expectations of raising $10,000 of the $75,000. We would, we've already partnered with the youth sports, youth soccer, youth football, and youth lacrosse, has committed over the 10 years to help us at a tune of $10,000 per year, because they're the primary users. We're in a situation where if you go to a lot of the turf fields in the area, you'll go there on a weekend and you'll see kids from everywhere playing on it. You come here, you'll see Pembroke kids playing on it. It's either our youth sports or our high school who uses that field 95% of the time, obviously with their opponents coming from outside. So we partner with youth sports to help fund that, to get to our self-funding 75. Third is we're gonna allocate some of the money that we've received in energy savings through the green community relationship. I think we've talked about that here in the past. I think hopefully everybody understands that and remembers that. Relighting and a bunch of other projects that we've done, there's a $35,000 savings. So that, again, gets us closer to the 75. What we're looking to do is reallocate $20,000 of the Medicaid reimbursement that the town receives every year for special education payments. We just talked about the high increase of special education to the district. Well, some of those students who qualify for Medicaid, we get a reimbursement from the federal government via the state. They pay us a part of that tuition that we pay, or part of the services. They give us they give us a reimbursement. We expect that number to continue to rise as our special education costs rise, and $20,000 is only a portion of the annual amount. We didn't want to go with one of the higher amounts, understanding that if the number shifted negatively or against us, we didn't want to count a revenue source that would be a potential problem. Finally, we're going to take the last $5,000 out of our operating budget within our, mostly within our athletics area, because that's who is going to be using it. If you can go back to our numbers, we have, you know, about 65% of our population, maybe a little bit more, 68, I think was the example. 68% participate in a sport. Most of those sports utilize our track and turf. Clearly the only ones who don't, ice hockey, basketball. But other than that, you know, lacrosse, obviously track and field, soccer, football, use that turf on a regular basis. So that's why we're looking to replace it now. I'd like to tell you, we would look for a good time to do it. However, we're not going to replace it early, but we can't replace it late because of the potential dangers it would cause from not having a something that was, you know, suitable for play. So I know that was a little bit more than your question, but I'm sure all those things you wanted to ask.
But planning, so it's least disruptive to all those groups. That's a big thing.
Yeah, we had been planning to actually do
that. No, but I mean, that's one question that the people are going to ask, because, you know, that's some of the questions that the people say to me out there, you know, is why do they have to replace the turf field now? Because if the state turns around and gives you more money than what you expected anyway, and that's helping on the budget to make the budget balance, it just seems that this extra this part here that's coming in now is going to bring you back down again, so you need more money.
Well, thank you for saying that this is not extra, first of all, because that's the way we see it, too. This is not extra.
Right. No, I understand that.
To answer your question just concisely, like we do with reviewing our special education programs, we ask every year from the superintendent, and we review our grounds and their maintenance. So at year 10, we were asking the question, does it have to be done now?
Yep.
At year 11, at year 12. At year 13, we made the decision that it has to be done now.
Mm-hmm. And the reality, Bill, is I think it's a fair question, because $809,000 is a lot of money. But I will tell you, having the kids that actually are on that track in my house on a regular basis, you know, there's divots in the track. There are divots in the turf. Yeah, you know, these kids, there's a point where...
I have no doubt about that, but that's what people don't know.
No, that's exactly right.
And I'm sure if it didn't need it, you wouldn't ask for it.
No, so. But your question's a fair one, and it allows that to get out, right?
Yeah.
You know, we're at the point now, in not doing it, we risk injury, and we risk actually the ability to be allowed to actually hold events from an MIA perspective on the turf and on the track. So... it absolutely does need to be done.
We just want to be responsible, and we don't want it to go too far, because after year 10, that's when we started questioning, and so we're in between 10 and 15, so we're here now.
Any other questions from the board?
I have one comment to make. As a frequent user of the track, I can vouch for what they're all saying about it being to be replaced right now. Another question I had is, how long do you envision this this project taking place?
Good question. So it'll probably take about 2 months, start to finish. One of the reasons why it's in the special and not the annual is that allows us to start clearly after town meeting votes. However, we have up until potentially June 5th or so that we could be using that between regular season contests and the state tournament. So our plan is to, as soon as town meeting, actually prior to town meeting approval, so we would get the bids. So once we got approval, we could go through the bid awarding process. And then as soon as we know we're done, depending upon whether, you know, whether we end up holding any regional track meets or whether we qualify mostly in lacrosse for the state tournament, we would look to see, okay, what's the South Sectional semifinal date, which I think is the last venue time you can hold an event, and then we would schedule for right after. The key part for us is we need to be out of there or done with it by the beginning of August, because football starts early and band camp starts early. So our marching band, which if you've ever been to a game, is outstanding, or if you want to and you don't want to go to the school, you can come to my backyard, you can hear them through, you know, literally, they're that sound.
Absolutely.
It's
an invitation to everyone.
But it's, if they use it also for their practice, so I guess it's another use of it, is a lot of students who are in the marching band, they use it for their band camp in the summer.
Which is another reminder that we have a home football game for Thanksgiving this year. It's not only a spectacular football game, right, Arthur? It's a spectacular band performance. So there's no fun.
This summer, though, that's what I wanted to do. And I'll give you some other running passes.
Dan?
All right.
Oh, Arthur, you can go.
Well, I just have two questions and a statement. And the statement is, it's fantastic that 20% of the student body is in the band. So that's it's a great accomplishment. But Rockland, Abington, Silver Lake, and Holbrook all have done fields over in the last year or two at the most. They've all gone with grass. And
Abington is definitely not grass, and I don't believe Rockland was. We looked at the cost of the two, but I can tell you I was on the Abington field yesterday, the Abington fields. They went with two fields. They went with a full football field used for football and lacrosse and soccer, and they have a soccer-only field. And both of them are lit, and that's part of the new school building project.
Well, the Frolio school that they're using for, I think, for football is still grass.
So, Arthur, we actually like that. So we let that.
I'm just anticipating the question.
Yeah, no, let's look at the cost.
It's a good one. And I think what we, so when we sat down and, because advisory had asked a similar question a few months back, so we looked at putting down grass as well as turf. One of the big issues we have is we don't have a well that's ready to go in an irrigation system that's ready to go in that segment. So it would add to the cost of the overall project. The upkeep and the maintenance of the grass when it's baking, you know, over the summer, and you know that the runoff there is pretty high and what have you. What we found is that it was just cost prohibitive to dig the wells, because it could be more than one, put in an irrigation system, and have the constant upkeep of that component as opposed to the turf. We just found it to be more expensive.
Yeah, and you'd have to have a growing season.
That's right. That's right. Well. And you'd have to alternate for non-use and everything else, which we just don't have the luxury of being able to do.
In which case, our home game would become an away game. The other thing is, and I hate to be bringing ants to the picnic, but what if it fails?
What if it fails?
The vote.
But you know, if it fails, we're gonna. I think the athletic offering and the ability to host games and everything else would be incredibly impacted. There is a possibility that home games could be at Silver Lake,
or that would be somewhere we could go with our home games. Some schools, as you know, when they were doing their building projects, went to an all-away schedule. We may have to consider that. So the way the field is judged on usage, and people look at the carpet and they say that, okay, oh, the carpet is matted or whatever, the carpet has rips in it. Over the years, you sew pieces back together, the numbers, because they're separate pieces. Hash marks, that type of stuff. But what would happen is we would reevaluate the compression test, because the compression test was close this last time. And that's how turf fields are judged on the usage. Clearly, obviously, rips and things like that. But the compression is of the material below, because then, as you know, it compresses and gets harder, and that's really where the danger lies on these fields. So if you walked on one of the newer fields and walked on ours, there's a noticeable difference.
I think the important thing for folks to understand is that we've taken some really creative steps to make sure that the bond can be self-funded. Right, everything from partnership with youth sports, and I know Mike and I, as part of the budget subcommittee, we're talking to the youth sports folks over the last three or four months. They've been very willing to make the contribution toward the amount. There will be a fee increase, so you know the families whose kids use it will be making an additional contribution from that perspective. There's a range of things, so the money's it. So we just had all of the parking lots relamped as part of the Green Communities effort, as well as all the schools, all the bulbs and everything changed out. And that savings is going to be reinvested back to this bond. So that there are significant strides that have been made to make sure that this can be self-funded without it being accretive to the overall budgetary number. And that's important, because what it really means is we found a way, $20,000, we can go back and forth with and have a different discussion maybe, but we found a way to really pay for this in the confines of our existing operating budget.
Okay, and the way scheduled, all games being on the road, you have an increased cost in transportation.
Transportation, that's right.
Yeah, you hope it offsets by, well, you'd have increased transportation, and then one of those away contests would be played as a home game, so you'd still be responsible for officials. So you wouldn't bypass any cost on your athletic budget, potentially, and not even a trainer, because if that school didn't have a trainer on staff, they'd still be responsible for either bringing a trainer, supplying it, or as we do for some events, we'll use EMTs.
Yeah.
So it's not as simple as...
It's not as simple, and really, it's clearly not a luxury, and something we've done a lot of homework on, the funding. You know, as Patrick said, we did look at the cost of grass versus turf. Even if without the well, it still becomes more expensive over the long run, which was the same information we were given 15 years ago, or about 15 years ago when it was put in, 13 to be exact. But it's not something that we can continue to delay, in which we have been delaying it because we didn't say, oh, okay, let's do it. We wanted to get every useful season out of it before we decided to it needed to be replaced.
Yeah. Yes, if we just change the conversation a little bit. There's been a lot of talk in the news lately about the Chapter 70 funding formula being re-looked at. And the part that scares me is that it's all the noise has been coming from big cities.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems to me that if the funding changes to further assist big cities, that could be a detriment to this town.
They just went through a process to look at it. We joined the Suburban Coalition a year ago because during the last review of it. And clearly it's still not getting better. You know, the one thing that I know we've asked for, I specifically asked for, and I put this out in the Suburban Coalition too, why don't you tie a portion of the formula back to tax revenue generated by the community through income tax? Because now you're at least trying to allocate some back based on what's being paid. Clearly they don't want to do that because the cities and towns aren't going to be able to, per capita, push this money back. Some of the cities. The problem we have, and when I say we, I just don't mean this town, but I also mean towns like us, is we represent a smaller voting block up on Beacon Hill. Therefore, even when you get all the towns coming together, it's not going to change where the votes are, which is why we came up with some of the proposals we did, you know, for Representative Cutler and Senator DiMacedo, because they're town government in size agnostic. Because if we try to say something about, oh, you should ignore per capita income, you should ignore median home value from the formula, it's not going to stay. Those are changes that aren't going to happen. So we just keep trying to propose other things that at least give everybody a share of the pie. Because the pie, I don't know if the pie is getting bigger. Everybody says it's getting bigger, but our pie isn't getting
bigger. But to your point, but then every couple of years, this bubbles up. I mean, we had a very open and blunt piece of dialogue with Representative Cutler and Senator DiMacedo a couple of years ago up at Pembroke High School when we were in the height of what I would call our budget crisis. And, you know, we kind of said, look, enough is enough, right? And we've gone through this. They've been back and forth. And to Mike's point, they've reviewed the formula. It gets reviewed constantly. So is it possible? Sure. I mean, there's 100 things that are possible inside the formula. I think they purposely make it as complex as possible so normal people just can't understand it and just accept what they ultimately push our way. I think the reality is that number in that formula is going to be what it's going to be. I think to Mike's point, what we have to do is start putting pressure on our elected representatives to help with things like unfunded mandates. I mean, you just saw the majority of our increases, and a huge piece of our increases are from mandates that are law passed on Beacon Hill by the Commonwealth, for which we received no funding for, and for which we have no ability to control, and we only have to absorb. So that is probably the best place that we can be the most impactful and most favorable to Pembroke.
I'd like to ask a question on the funding of the field. How solid are you on those numbers?
On the funding piece? On the payment piece?
On the cost of the field and how you're going to pay for it.
So the way we're going to pay for it, absolutely solid.
Okay.
Clearly, the other items goes out to bid, but we feel pretty confident based upon the way other projects have been bid recently.
Yeah, there's not one of us, and I don't want to speak for all five of us, but I think it's safe to say there's really not one of us that would say that we have a huge amount of concern about the funding piece or the cost estimate. You know, we've talked about the cost estimate in public session multiple times over the past several months. Exactly the point is, we want to be conservative enough to protect the downside without being so conservative that it's an inflated number that candidly you're asking for something that you ultimately don't need. We believe that number, the number of $890,000 is extremely solid, and the funding mechanisms there are also solid.
Well, I ask that because the funding is so tight.
Yeah.
Based on the dollars, it looks like it's going to work fine unless you're $100,000 off for some reason.
It clearly is tight. However, one of the things that is going in our favor right now is interest rates, which are expected to rise at least once or twice more this year or next year. So doing it now does give us some benefit, which is why we're acting on it, and then why these numbers should hold is we're in a favorable interest rate environment when you're talking about financing, you know, $690,000. Right, if you just straight line your principal, that's $69,000 a year versus an estimated payment of $75,000, you know, is what we've gotten from, you know, the town account. Now, granted, it fluctuates year to year. But when you're looking at that, you're not looking at massive amounts of interest, which is at least a positive for the project.
Right.
You know, the other thing I would say is I think you've got the benefit of having five professionals sitting in front of you, right? Many of us manage huge budgets for business and everything else. And I think at the end of the day, we're willing to absorb that risk, you know, and only ask for what we're asking for in order to make sure that can happen. I think we're that confident in saying that, you know, that we will take on that budgetary risk if there is one, and with certainty be able to say that we're not going to ask for more than what is on this piece of paper.
Oh, that sounds good to me. And the other comment I would make is that I like your point about a potential 15-year life, and you're looking at 12 or 13 with the idea that you could put aside some money for the next field.
So one thing to make clear, we've gotten got to 13 out of this by maintenance every year. We do own our own brush so that we can brush it. If you go to some of even the newer fields, they start to mat if they don't get brushed frequently. When the turf was bought the first time, you know, the building committee bought the brush so that we could do it on a regular basis, and then reseed it with those wonderful pellets, which if you ever walk on it, you end up getting them in your shoes. It's awesome. Your kids will put them all over the house. It's an extra benefit, I guess, but you get to take home some of the turf with you. But we do things like that because we want to make sure it's obviously good for our kids to play on, but then also we get the most out of it. We don't want to be coming and saying, oh, you know what, we mistreated the turf, which is why we, you know, have to get a new one earlier. And I think that was one of the drivers behind our partnership with U Sports, is we talked to them and said, like, hey, you folks use it. Help us out a little bit. You can also, it has them show ownership towards the project, and they can feel a part of it. So we came up, it was a creative process to come up with that. What we're doing for their part is guaranteeing them so many hours during their season so that they can use the field and they know they're not going to get blocked out because, you know what, Track's decided that they don't want practice at 8 in the morning, they're going to move it to 10, so I'm not picking on Track, but you can't use it today. We're blocking them into hours, us into hours, and then we'll figure out what to do with the access.
Bill?
Yeah, I just have one other comment, and This isn't the first time that you've come before the Board of Selectmen and wanting to go in front of town meeting for this particular article that's in your budget. And you went back and took a look at it. And that's I think, good on my part to say you people went back. So, I mean, you could have gone for it before, but you went back and took a look at it, looked at all your figures, checked everything all out again, went through all of your paperwork to what's right. And I think that people should appreciate that.
I appreciate it, Bill.
Yeah, and the reason why is, yeah, we wanted to make sure we're better on the funding source. And, you know, to Patrick's point about, you know, five professionals, hopefully people between this and our regular budget, the number of hours we spend making sure we vet things out properly, and also understanding that while we don't get as many people as you do at your meetings, we do spend a lot of time, you know, challenging the administration on not only what, why, how much, but also when is the right time, whether it's this project or anything else.
Yeah.
Aaron's nodding her head and smiling because
yeah, I appreciate so, that.
It's our fiduciary obligation to the community. So just so you know, when we come forth, whether it's the budget or this project, every one of the five of us brings a different perspective, and we push hard on them to make sure that what we're doing is not only the right thing, you know, for the students, but also has the taxpayers in mind too, because they're the ones funding this. And
you know, I think though, and I appreciate the comment, Bill, actually a lot, because we take the job more than just seriously, but we also know that our ask of you is impacting other areas of town government, right? I mean, the piece of our pie is finite, and it's something that we've struggled with. We spent a lot of time trying to look for additional revenues earlier in the year, and the reality is there's not a lot out there, right, for additional revenues for the town that we haven't acted upon. You know, we've executed the restaurant tax, we've executed a whole series of things, a couple of pieces of land that we might be able to develop to sort of generate an annuitized revenue stream down the road. But the reality is our pie is finite, so we take very seriously our ask of all of you, and we take very seriously the ask of this town, because we understand, you know, look, the police and fire guys have an absolute valid ask of needing more help, right? They've got the same number or less people than they had 15, 20 years ago, and a town that's grown substantially. We have all other areas of town government that have an equal sort of need, and I think it's something that the five of us are constantly trying to balance our ask of you, you know, versus the need of the student body, as well as our legally required responsibility based on the laws of the Commonwealth. So it is something that we talk about a lot in our meetings, and making sure that what we bring to you is balanced and fiscally conservative and responsible budget as we can.
I think we appreciate that.
Thank you.
Anything else? Thank you very much for coming.
Sir, so let me just ask one last question. I'm sorry. Do you think it makes sense for us to come potentially a week or two before town meeting and have another, whether at least put it on the agenda to have a potential discussion? If you think it's not worth it, you think you're good with it, us, we don't have
then
to
we
have it.
Up.
But us, you won't show up. We can take it off. But do you think we should pencil in another time just to get together on where we stand?
Mr. Chairman, I would say that we would welcome the school committee back when we have sort of the dry run for town meeting, that we go over the articles with moderator Dodge, to have the school committee back and, you know, talk about it when it's a hot topic, because town meeting's coming up. I think Mike's got a great idea.
We don't want to come in or take extra time. However, if you think it'll be helpful to your making your decision, but also informing the public, we're happy to do so.
We have that scheduled for April 24th, a joint meeting with the moderator advisory and the selectman.
Right.
So you could pencil that in, as they like to say. And with the continued discussion about the dollars here, maybe you'll feel that you'd like to come. maybe you don't think it's necessary, but...
Well, I think it would be important for you to come, because one of the mistakes that we try to avoid that could easily happen is that we know so much about what's going on in town, and so do you. Mm-hmm. We just make the mistake of thinking that everyone else knows.
Yep.
So I would say have the conversation here, an open meeting, even though we may already know everything there is to know about that. To have it, a public meeting is important.
It makes us, we are good stewards, and we know that, but we have to communicate that, all of us.
Certainly.
We're all doing this because we want to be good stewards. I think we are.
Well, it's April 24th at 7:30.
See you there.
Okay.
All right.
Now, we have another item on our agenda here, which is the special town meeting article for the funding of the turf field. And the board needs to state what our position is on that article. And it's to see if the town will vote to raise and appropriate, transfer from available funds, or borrow a sum of money for costs associated with the installation of a turf field at the Pembroke High School. And so we've just heard all the reasons why that we need it and how it's going to be funded. So I would look for a motion of support from the board on Article 2.
I would move favorable action.
Second.
Moved by Arthur for favorable action, seconded by Matthew. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, hearing none. I deem that unanimous. So we have favorable action on Article 2 on the special town meeting.
Thank you for your support.
And we'll see you on the 24th at 7:30. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so we'll stay with the action item, which is to review the remaining articles 2 through 7 and 12 and 21 to vote recommendations. We've already done the special on Article 2. Okay, so Article 12, which was to provide $5,000 for the South Shore Community Action Council to provide services to residents of the town. And we had previously voted favorable action. Since that time, the budget picture has produced recommendations on financial articles that vary from take no action to town meeting floor. And two similar articles, a petition article for the South Shore Women's Research Center for $3,500 and for health initiatives for $1,500, received a recommendation of town meeting floor. We need to discuss and review our vote to either maintain our previous votes or to vote to take no action on all three of these articles, as we have previously discussed, due to the availability of funds. Do we have any questions?
Yes. So has the availability of funds changed so much where $5,000 is now off the table? And what specifically about this makes it less valuable than, per se, other articles?
Well, that's the point. We believe all articles are important. And the fact that the selectmen took a stand last week on having take no action on all articles that deal with monies in excess of Article 2, which is the general budget.
Thank you.
So we would recommend that these three articles, in keeping with the board thought last week, that all three articles would have a take no action from the Board of Selectmen.
Okay. Any other questions about that recommendation? Hearing none, is there a motion?
The town administrator's recommendation is that we move to take no action on the three articles. Is that?
Yes, sir.
That's correct. That's the correct recommendation.
These things hurt when you come down to $5,000, as Matthew was saying. But given the fact that we've asked the police and the fire to wait, I think for consistency's sake, we have to request that these folks wait as well. So I would move the town administrator's recommendation.
Second.
Motion by Arthur for a vote of take no action on these three articles, seconded by Dan. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. Okay.
Article 2, Mr. Chairman, is the pay plan for non-union workers.
Yes.
And, according to town accountant and myself, we are recommending favorable action on 2% cost of living increase for non-union employees.
I would move the town administrator's recommendation.
Motion by Arthur for favorable action on Article 2. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Bill. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of favorable action, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, that's unanimous.
Mr. Chairman, Article 3 is the operating budget. This has been amended slightly to reflect the savings that we will see for the health insurance premiums. Mr. Buckley is before the advisor right now, I believe, and explaining this budget to advisory. And Mr. Buckley and I are recommending favorable action for Article 3.
Does anyone have any questions on Article 3, which is the town budget as explained by Ed? Are there any questions on this article?
I would move the town administrator's recommendation.
Motion by Arthur for favorable action, a second by Bill. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none. Unanimous.
Article 4 is the Water Enterprise Fund, which is supported by water revenue.
We have the recommendation by the town administrator on that article.
I'll move the town administrator's recommendation.
Second.
Favorable action has been recommended by a motion by Arthur and seconded by Bill. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, that's unanimous.
Chairman, Article 5 is the Solid Waste Enterprise Fund. It's funded solely by user fees.
And you are recommending favorable action?
Yes, sir. We're actually built in some monies that I know that the because of the popularity of the recycling center. And Mr. Valenti reported to me today that they set a record on Saturday for a number of cars that have been at the recycling center, equaling almost hazardous waste day. And so it may be something that we should look at starting the new fiscal year, that maybe, we talked about this before, about extending the hours on Saturday.
Right.
From 10 to 3, which is what it is now, to maybe 9 to 5 or 6. So we had those numbers plugged in for the recycling attendance.
Ed, do you know what the majority of people are dropping off on a Saturday?
Recyclables.
But I mean to say, is it large recyclables, like white goods, or are people not using the curbside to their ability, of their abilities, or are they just out for a nice little Sunday afternoon?
I think what they did, number one, it was a nice day, and so people are getting, cleaning up the yards.
Yeah.
So a lot of brush, but we're also seeing recyclables that people actually generate more recyclables than they ever thought they were. Cardboard, paper, bottles, what have you. And so they know, even though we do it every week, they continue to bring those recyclables, single stream recyclables, to the recycling center. The amount of tonnage for cardboard and for bottles and for metals continues to rise.
Can I also add that about extending the hours, it seems like we have the basis for doing that on Saturday. But a couple of times a year, we also consider opening on Sunday.
That's right.
So we might want to throw that into the mix of extended hours on Saturday.
Yeah, I think what I'll talk to Mike about is, when do you think we would start having it on Sundays for, you know, a 2-3-4 week period? I think that period might be starting about now.
Yeah. Right.
Recommend favorable action on 5.
May I ask one more question, Mr. Chairman?
Certainly.
Ed, could you explain the salary increase in the solid waste budget?
Yeah, that's the extra hours that we plugged in for FY18 for the recycling attendants, and we're going to add an additional recycling attendant. So that's the increase in the salaries.
Okay, thank you.
Projected hour at least on Saturdays, and we have a little cushion there for the 3 or 4 days in the fall and in the spring that we are open on Sundays as well.
All right, thank you.
Okay, we have a motion for favorable action on Article 5. And did we get a second on that?
Second.
We did. Second by Matthew, thank you. All those in favor of favorable action on Article 5, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. It's unanimous. We have Article 6, Ed.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, this is the article that funds collective bargaining agreements, and we have agreements for DPW, clerical, and the superior officers. We've already had money allocated for the police budget that was, the police contract that was executed in the fall.
Just a question, did you get these into advisory in time to review them?
Oh yeah, they got them all last Thursday.
Okay.
Friday was the drop dead date for the all memorandums of agreement.
Yeah. Good point, Arthur. We mandated to do that, so.
That's, you know, that's the best thing that we did was to have that 30-day window.
Right.
Because as you know, Arthur, I mean, we were signing contracts right at town meeting.
Yeah, and that's really unfair to the voters and to the advisory committee members.
Recommend favorable action.
Article 6, favorable action, is recommended by Bill. Second by Arthur. All those in favor of favorable action, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. That's unanimous. Article 7. Is an article that would allow us to place a sum of money in the stabilization fund. And Ed has a recommendation on that.
Yeah, this might be the easiest decision we could make because obviously we're going to be using every available source of revenue to balance our FY18 budget. So right now, Mr. Buckley and I are recommending that we take no action putting money into the stabilization at this time.
So moved.
Moved by Bill, second by Arthur, to take no action on Article 7. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, hearing none, that's unanimous. Now, we have a subject that...
Before we go on, I just had a question. Do we have to close the meeting warrant since we've reopened it?
Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
Yeah, thank you, Dan. Is there a motion, Dan?
So moved, close the town meeting warrant.
Thank you. Second by Arthur. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, hearing none. Dan has also asked for an item to be placed on the agenda, so let me turn it over to Dan.
Right, and I just wanted the board to have information in front of them regarding the so-called Safe Communities Act to make Massachusetts a sanctuary state. It's a piece of Senate legislation. I wanted to make sure this board had the information in front of you. I don't know if it's if this board wants to take action as a whole as a board or discuss it tonight and take a vote and let our Senator Vinnie DiMacedo and also our Representative Josh Cutler understand our feelings on this, or we could just take this as a point of information and contact them ourselves. So I'll put it to the board for discussion.
Thank you. I'd just like to add something, if I may. We've got a lot of good information in our packet on this Senate bill. So if you haven't had enough time to look at it, there's a lot of good stuff in there that tells you exactly what is being proposed. I also found that the governor has not yet committed himself to this, and the Speaker of the House has not, and the President of the Senate has not. And I understand that maybe some issues with funding, which may be withheld from the state, from the White House, if this was accepted, seems to be contrary to what the President would like to see done. So I'm sure they're very concerned about that, and I would like, before I committed myself, I would like to kind of wait a week or two and see if they have anything new to say about this, because they are the leaders, and if they're not supporting it or they're not against it, at least today they're not, they could be tomorrow either one way or the other. And so I would like to hear from them. So I leave it open for any comments from the board.
The only comment that I have is that I don't think it's a good idea as a sanctuary city or a sanctuary state. It's sending the wrong message to the people that we can continue doing what we're doing and not enforce the laws of the Commonwealth or the laws of federal government or whatever. This act here stops ICE and federal authorities from arresting illegal immigrants and all that. And I don't think that that's good for the town, and I don't think it's good for the people. So I would be against it 100% myself. But I don't know how the board feels about it, but I would definitely be against it. Whether the Senate or the representatives are for it or not, my vote would be against it.
I'm certainly against it. I think it's wrong. I think it's anti-law enforcement, and I think it's it makes Massachusetts less safe. It's bad enough that some cities and towns are doing it on their own, but an entire state to. So, one of the things I wanted to do with this is bring this information before the board. I didn't want to overly politicize it. It's the large political discussion that's larger than this board, but I do want to make sure the board has information so that we can reach out at least individually, to our representatives. I think it's important for them to know, because they've had some votes taken up there that might have gone a different way if they had more outreach from their communities. They may not have voted themselves a huge raise if they had enough communities saying, please don't. I don't know if that's the case or not, but I think we should be heard. Let them know our opinions.
Well, most definitely, I think that you know, we should make a stand on it. It's not supporting that, because it's you say Safe Communities Acts, this is nothing about being a safe community. This is about opening a door and allowing illegal people to come into this country and this state and this town, and law enforcement not have the authority to arrest them and bring them forward. And no matter what the law enforcement does, they go before a court, they go before a justice, they make a decision whether this person is allowed to stay here or not. What this Safe Communities Act here is doing is that, and I'm sure that what the president's going to do, he's going to turn around and say, if you're a sanctuary state, then you're not getting federal money. And that's something that we can't afford to do, would be to turn around and have any conflict with the federal government saying that we're not going to get federal funds, because Boston comes right out and says, as far as we're concerned, we'll take all of the people up there. It's ridiculous. The laws are made for the people that come in. I have friends today that came in from foreign countries. They went through all of this, and they did it the right way. They don't come into the country illegally and work here and take benefits, go to school, get free college, get free money, get all of this other stuff that is not afforded to our veterans and other people, and continue to do that. And somebody can't even bring them forward to a justice to say that it's wrong to do that. It's absurd. I don't believe in it. So.
Any other comments?
I think some great points have been made, but I must also add that if this law were to pass, it'd really remove our own ability to enforce our own laws here in our town. So that's why I must stand against it.
Okay. One thought that we could do is we could table this for 2 weeks and read through this material, if you haven't already, and give it a little more thought, and then come back and make a decision, or we could do something this evening.
Well, I think what you asked, that you want a little bit more information before you vote. I don't have a problem with that, but I think that we definitely should, and hopefully it would be an affirmative vote to not support this.
So is that a motion then?
I would move that we continue it for 2 weeks so that you or anybody else on the board wants to look into anything else about it and come back and get a proper vote. That's not much to ask. So. Okay.
Second.
Motion by Bill and a second by Dan. Any other comments? Hearing none, all those in favor of the table this for 2 weeks, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, that's unanimous. Do we have any old business to discuss?
I do, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Bill.
Probably several weeks ago, Gary Gumperight gave me a call and actually sent me a picture of a veteran sign in a in another town in Weymouth, I believe it was, at their town hall. So he asked me if there was something we could do about that here in Pembroke, and I contacted the director of the DPW. He actually changed the name from Weymouth to Pembroke, made a sign very similar to that if you look out in the parking lot here today, I actually took a picture of it and put it on Facebook, but so that the people know and the veterans know that they have a special parking place for veterans at the police station today, and it's a new sign has been erected out there. It's very nice.
Very good. I remember the picture that you showed us. It was impressive, very nicely done.
Yeah.
Clearly defined.
Yeah, we
so
actually,
that's good.
Yeah, we actually have a new picture of the, I'll probably show you here, if I can find it. Okay, it's right out in the front. It said, reserved for veterans parking, and it has Town of Pembroke on the seal, so.
Excellent.
So it's right out by the main front door. So it's, I don't know if you saw it when you came in, but.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah, so it's real nice. So.
I think that was a very good suggestion by Gary.
Yeah.
And see to it that you follow through with that, Bill. Thank you.
Well, I appreciate the DBW of acting so quick on it and getting it taken care of. So.
Any other old business? Hearing none, we'll move to the town administrator's report.
I have nothing tonight.
Is there any issue on Ask the Selectmen?
I do.
Yes, Dan.
I received a call from a resident who's seen a headstone at Pembroke Center Cemetery knocked over. Clearly a veteran's stone, so she thought. So she contacted the DPW about the toppled over stone. So I just wanted to bring it out to this board, and maybe Ed, if you could follow up on that for her, that'd be great. It's right when you drive in the center, off of Center Street.
I know we've seen issues like that on a larger scale that have occurred in other towns, and it makes you wonder what the thinking is of the people that would do something.
I don't think it was, she didn't think it was purposely toppled over. It might have been just a frost eve that knocked it over.
Oh, that's great. That's much better.
That's what it seemed like to her.
That's good.
Yeah, it's one of the old white ones that is on the road as just as you come in. And generally the DPW has done a good job with putting them back up.
Right.
But I would agree with you. I think it's probably not an act of vandalism.
I don't think so. She would have said.
Okay. New business. Arthur and I were contacted by Mr. John Mahoney of the Town of Plymouth Board of Selectmen. And Mr. Mahoney is looking for this board to support the Plymouth Selectmen in opposing the pay raise, which will be coming up for a vote for the Plymouth County Commissioners.
So moved.
Motion has been made by Dan. Is there any discussion?
I'll let him finish his information first. It was tongue-in-cheek, but I will move it afterwards.
Yeah, the thing I'm looking for is some direction from the board, because, you know, I certainly have feelings one way or the other on this, and if I'm going to be the representative of the board, I want to carry the from the majority, as I'm not legally bound to vote that way, but quite candidly, I would take direction from the board, and I would not, you know, let personal feelings get involved.
Is this another raise?
Yeah, a little background on it. When I held that position for Pembroke that Arthur now holds, the Plymouth County Commissioners were making $7,500. They had been down to zero, and then when things got a little better, they were given $7,500 as a minimum, and I understood that was direction from the state. So they had asked for more. So they were at $7,500, and then they got another raise after that a couple of years later, and now they want to go to $28,000. And we have three Plymouth County commissioners for you folks at home that are not aware of that. And their argument, to give them their due here, is that they had been making $28,000 some time ago prior to economic conditions which caused them to go down to zero. And their tenure in office, their claim is that they have increased the economic outlook for Plymouth County to the point where they would like to go back to their original salary of $28,000, and they're saying it's not really a raise, but that's...
Reinstatement, that's what they're calling it.
Reinstatement, thank you. So that vote will be coming up at an upcoming meeting. I don't have the date for that meeting, but Arthur will be representing the town of Pembroke and all of the towns in Plymouth County that are on the advisory board. They have a vote, and their vote, depending on their population, is given a certain weight. And so they add up the yea and the nays with their appropriate vote, and I guess that's how they decide. But the Plymouth Board of Selectmen is very adamant that they not get this increase to $28,000, and they are looking for our support. And one of their arguments is that John Buckley down at the Registry of Deeds has been fighting to get his budget back to where it was before, and so that he can service the people that go there. And that is a revenue generating agency. And so he's had a very difficult time. And Plymouth's position is that if there's money to be had, that it should go to the Registry of Deeds, who has been shorthanded for a number of years. So that's the question, and they would like our support. And so I think we should let our voice be heard either one way or the other. Any other comments?
Move to table it for 2 weeks so we can check on it further.
You want to table it for 2 weeks?
Yeah.
When's the vote? When do we need someone down there?
That I'm not sure.
The vote is, I think it's a week from Thursday.
Table it 1 week then.
But we won't meet in a week.
We won't be meeting next Monday. It's a holiday.
I'm going to suggest boldly, without having talked to Matthew beforehand, is to make him the alternate in the event that it's a conflict, because I have a Board of Health obligation in Holbrook on one of those nights. But he's not been down to Plymouth County, as far as I know, and it would be a nice night to get some experience, clearly.
Yeah, I accept that. Thank you.
I don't know if we need a vote on that.
Yeah, I think we should have a vote to name Matthew the our alternate representative at Plymouth County.
So moved.
Moved by Bill, seconded by Arthur. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none.
So one of the things that's important for us to go there for, Arthur or Matt, if you go, is we just want this board's push should be for fiscal responsibility from the county commissioners, and that alone, because there is a conflict, a personality conflict, with one or many of the selectmen and the county commissioners. So we don't want to get caught up in anything like that. The only thing that we need to be responsible for is that they are fiscally responsible. And giving themselves a raise without first reestablishing Mike Buckley's Buckley's office, I don't think that's the most fiscally responsible thing that they could be doing at this point.
Good point, Dan.
So looking for some direction from the board, would they be in favor or opposed?
I would be opposed to allowing the raise to go through. But for no other reason than the money should be spent elsewhere.
I would agree with that assessment.
Dan's statement in the form of a motion.
That is a motion.
A motion by Dan not to be in favor of the Plymouth County Commissioner's raise. We have a second.
Second.
Second by Matthew. Motion and second, and all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
I'll stand present not voting because I have to carry the torch.
Okay, Arthur is not going to vote on this. He votes present. So that's four votes yes and one vote present.
That way I can't be accused of bias, but I take direction from the board and it seems clear to me that they're opposed.
Good, thank you, Arthur. Any other questions from anyone or issues?
Mr. Chairman, I have two issues to bring up under new business. So the first one would be, I met with Ken Horn tonight, and he's putting together a grassroots effort to fight illegal drugs in Pembroke, so I just wanted to voice my support for that. And the second thing I wanted to talk about was, a few weeks back I talked about researching putting hydro turbines into the North River, and after meeting with a concerned citizen on the matter, who's actually in the room tonight, it turns out this would be a very, very bad idea for Pembroke, so no longer looking into that.
Okay. All new ideas are good until they prove otherwise. So that's good. Thank you, Matthew. Anything else? Okay, we have some upcoming issues. First of all, we will not be meeting next Monday, the 17th. It's a holiday. So our next meeting will be on the 24th. And at 7:30, we have a joint meeting with advisory, the town moderator, to discuss the annual town meeting articles. Also on the 24th, we will be signing the annual and the special within the annual town meeting warrants. On May 1st at 7 p.m., the DPW commissioners will give a presentation on space and needs study results. On May 9th at 7 p.m., the annual town meeting takes place at Learning Lane, the Pembroke High School, at 7 p.m. May 9th at 7 p.m., the town meeting. Seeing that we are not meeting next Monday, we have the issue of signing warrants. If the pleases the board, I would be available to sign those warrants and then make a report to the board on what was signed on the 24th.
I take that in the form of a motion. We grant you the authority.
Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. We have a need for executive session this evening, Ed?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we go into executive session on the Mass General Laws, Chapter 38, Section 21. Reason number three, to discuss strategy with respect to litigation if an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigation position of the public body and the chair so declares. Town of Pembroke Water Wheel Committee, and to discuss strategy with regards to collective bargaining and if an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigation position of the public body and the chair so declares. Superior Pembroke Police Superior Officers Association, MOA.
Second.
Motion by Bill and a second by Dan, and the chair does declare. There will be any need for returning into public session for a vote, Mr. Fine?
There may be, yes, sir.
So we will not adjourn the public meeting. We will be going into executive session. And again, there will be no meeting next Monday. So we will see you on the 24th, and we'll see you when we reconvene.
Happy Easter to everybody.
Happy Easter.
Call the vote.
Yes. Dan?
Yes.
Matthew?
Yes.
Bill?
Yes.
Arthur?
Yes.
And I vote yes. So we'll be going into executive session right now.
Extreme.
Good evening, everyone. It's 10 o'clock, and the Pembroke Board of Selectmen are back in public session. So we're going to take a vote on that contract.
Yes.
So we need to make a public vote on some business that we discussed tonight in executive session. So I'm looking for a motion.
I would move the memorandum of understanding with the lieutenant's bargaining unit.
Second.
Motion by Arthur and a second by Bill to approve a contract with the police department. Any questions? Hearing none. Take a vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. That's unanimous. Well, that does it for us tonight. Thank you. If you're out there watching, you're tuned in. We appreciate that. And we are not meeting next Monday night, so we'll see you on the 24th.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion to adjourn. Second by Arthur. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Happy Easter to everybody. Have a great Easter. My favorite holiday.
Very good. Happy Easter, I guess.
One of those Cadbury egg guys.
My wife's going to do a big egg hunt, Easter egg hunt, so.